Hello. Now, time for some art history. Thank you. I know you're ready after that to go back in time. I was invited to talk about artist couples in the early 20th century. And I couldn't resist this cheesy title, which I realize may make some of you think that I'm going to present a kind of oral coffee table book. But I'd suggest that when Vasily Kandinsky makes a romantic gouache of a walking lady to give to his lover, Gabriele Münter, or Sophie Taeuber makes a pair of portrait busts of her and her boyfriend, Hans Arp, that these works aren't incidental to the history of modernism. So yes, we're going back in time. But I'm saying that these are not just anecdotal asides that can supplement the serious labor of writing art history. I'd argue, rather, that the fact that there were unprecedented numbers of artist couples in the early 20th century negotiating dual career households is a key factor in how modern art took shape. Tonight, I'll focus on the work of two artist couples, Münter and Kandinsky, key players in the Blue Rider group of German Expressionism, and Taeuber and Arp, both Zurich Dadaists. We can only properly understand the emergence of abstract art as manifested in Expressionism and Dada, I argue, if we attend to their intimate working relationships. When I began this research, I was not looking at artist couples. I was interested in abstraction. I wanted to know why artists like Kandinsky had such a hard time breaking through to abstraction before World War I, and why it then spread so quickly during and right after the war, taking myriad forms, including the stark reduction of Taeuber and Arp's duo collages, so formally far from Kandinsky's superabundance. But then I realized something weird was going on with gender. The initial breakthrough to abstraction is generally described as an apotheosis of masculinity made possible through the repression of the decorative, read femininity. Kandinsky, who infamously described painting as a conquest of virgin canvas with imperious brush, is paradigmatic. As feminist scholars have noted, his rhetoric masked a dependence on innovations hatched within the applied arts. Kandinsky retained the distinction between fine and applied arts, even as he profited from the resources available in the decorative sphere. When Kandinsky arrived in Munich in 1896 to study art, Jugendstil, a German variant of Art Nouveau, was thriving. Jugendstil's proponents claimed equality between the fine and applied arts, and were often involved in making objects of both kinds. You can get a sense of Munich Jugendstil from this room, curated by the architect Theodor Fischer for an exhibition in 1897, which bursts with arabesques, knickknacks, and landscape painting. Kandinsky's Composition 7 of 1913 likewise crams a boggling variety of forms into a canvas large enough to envelop the viewer. It's about 6.5 by 10 feet. Early on, Kandinsky indulged in Jugendstil, making sketches for embroideries, for example, but by 1913, his focus was painting on an epic scale, even if critics harped that his, quote, orgies of color were better suited for carpets or wallpaper. Meanwhile, Münter, his wife in a marriage of conscience, remembered leaving abstraction to him, not willing to compete on his turf. She focused on landscapes, genre scenes, and still lifes, saying in 1956 that she had told Kandinsky that abstraction, quote, belonged to him. I would remain with nature, end quote. Leave the high-profile world historical innovations to the men, women stay modestly in their proper place. Yet, and this is where the weirdness comes in, art history provides us with an entirely different rendering of gender dynamics vis-a-vis abstraction if we turn from the breakup of the Blue Rider group at the outbreak of World War I in 1914 to Dada's birth in neutral Switzerland just 2 years later. Accounts of Zurich Dada rave about Taeuber as a born abstractionist, schooling her boyfriend Arp in the joys of geometry. Abstraction, we hear, came naturally to her as a textiles artist. She taught weaving and design at Zurich's School of Applied Arts. Here on the left, a gouache Taeuber likely made as a sketch for an embroidery. The rectangles would be easy to translate into cross-stitch. On the right, a collage by Arp made during his rectangles obsessed phase, which followed his meeting Taeuber in 1915. Between 1914 and 1916, we'd have to assume, a seismic shift occurred. Off limits to women at the moment of initial conquest, abstraction almost immediately became their natural domain. Moreover, whereas abstraction, according to the history books, was initially a source of competition between the sexes, it soon transformed into a vehicle for utopian transcendence of gendered inequalities. Taeuber and Arp's duo collages are a staple of histories of Dada, taken to be exemplary of the movement's elimination of hierarchies. Working together, Taeuber and Arp move beyond the constraints of their respective genders into a realm of harmonious give and take. We can make sense of this apparently radical shift by attending to the artists' actual working relationships. We learn first that the differences weren't so stark, the initial breakthrough not as misogynist as we come to believe, and the subsequent proliferation of abstraction not as progressive. Both pairs were feminist in that the women were ambitious in their careers and their partners supported their professional endeavors. But they embraced difference between the sexes, didn't aim to be absolute equals. Münter, as we've seen, didn't choose to compete on Kandinsky's grounds, and Taeuber didn't even have to worry about the question because during this Dada period, she firmly belonged to the world of the applied arts. At a definite remove from Arp, who flirted with craft but was no applied artist himself. What we learn about their biographies has significant bearing on artistic choices. By scrutinizing their close working relationships, we gain a better understanding of why Kandinsky repressed the decorative, why Münter left abstraction to him, and why Taeuber and Arp were empowered to pursue abstraction in media typically associated with the applied arts, including embroidery and turned wood. Kandinsky disavowed the decorative, yes, but he was particularly sensitive to the threat of femininity precisely because of his relationship with Münter. Whereas he could afford to exploit the risk of abstract art falling into the category of the decorative, she, as a woman, had to defend herself more militantly from such accusations. That Taeuber and Arp could embrace the decorative just a few years later had less to do with breakthroughs in feminism and more to do with the reassertion of the fine arts' comfortable dominance over applied arts. When Jugendstil was threatening established hierarchies, fine arts had been in danger of seeming derivative of applied arts. By 1916, it had shored up its boundaries. The consensus was again that applied arts were influenced by fine, not vice versa. In this context, the fine arts could withstand a greater level of subversion, i.e., abstraction. And women could engage in radical craft without threatening their insecure male peers. Returning to Kandinsky's night, we might think that his decorative sketches were just a side practice, an appropriate gift for his lover, pictorial versions of dresses he designed for Münter. But no, he took the decorative seriously, exhibiting the beaded purses he designed and Münter made at the Salon d'Automne in Paris in 1906. Münter and Kandinsky were the typical Jugendstil couple, both artists pursuing their art, but Münter was still stuck with the sewing. At the same time, they worked on their high art, early on plein air sketches, then more fauvist landscapes. They worked together closely, and their work sometimes looked almost interchangeable. Around 1909, something changed. They stopped collaborating, started focusing only on the fine arts, and increasingly differentiated their styles from each other. Kandinsky's paintings started getting more abstract, Münter's more brooding and mysterious. Given the critical uproar at this time accusing Jugendstil of emasculating the fine arts, for Münter to be taken seriously as an artist, she had to distance herself from the decorative. It's no accident that the scraggly bouquet in Still Life with Queen awkwardly blocks our entrance into the painting. We're supposed to stop and worry about our access, no longer able to assume we understand and possess her charming vision. Kandinsky, on the other hand, could take more risks, could withstand when critics attacked his paintings as carpet designs and even solicit these attacks, always coming back, for instance, to his fascination with Rococo ladies in this pastoral, which is in the Guggenheim's collection. He taunted his viewers, turning his daring to be compromised by associations with femininity into a show of machismo. I'm not saying Kandinsky was a saint, but his incorporation of the decorative wasn't a mindless repression. It was a self-conscious attempt at dialectical transcendence. He thought women and men could have it all, and that ultimately abstraction would sweep everyone into a newly harmonious era. Münter wasn't so sure, more mindful of the obstacles. Just a few years after all the anguish over whether and how to paint abstractly, we find Taeuber and Arp composing serenely reductive, yet unpredictable assortments of rectangles. Admittedly, these things are cool. Talk about giving up on gendered hierarchies. It's impossible here to tell who contributed exactly what to the process. But as far as I can tell, and I've looked hard, the couple's collaborations weren't exhibited publicly at the time. These works have become emblematic of Dada's interrogation of individual authorship. But for the most part, the Dadaists were content with conducting their bohemian business as usual. While Arp indulged in Dada shenanigans, Taeuber, who supported the couple financially, spent her days teaching and painstakingly crafting saleable goods like this beaded purse, or cross-stitching Arp's designs for him. When Arp exhibited embroideries in galleries hanging on the walls in lieu of paintings, critics were generally enthusiastic, a far cry from the responses Kandinsky had received for his abstractions, even though Kandinsky hadn't gone so far as to replace oil with cross-stitch. Meanwhile, when Taeuber exhibited her pillowcases and other wares, her abstracted designs were understood as derivative of the fine art movements, cubism, futurism, and expressionism. Forgotten the pre-war anxieties, forgotten the fact that applied artists had arrived at abstraction far before the avant-garde painters. With the fine arts firmly back on top, artists like Arp and Taeuber had greater leeway to experiment with embroidery and still be taken seriously. But they only took this freedom so far, reserving their most radical experiments for the private sphere. In public, Taeuber still had to make a name for herself to combat the persistent anonymity of the woman who sews. And Arp wasn't averse to making a name for himself either. In private, they could make objects whose authorship and function are inscrutable. There's currently active debate over the attribution of these vertical horizontal compositions. Note how the embroidery on the left is attributed to Taeuber, the one on the right to Arp. At the time, the artists didn't bother to lay individual claims on these objects, allowing us to wonder who made what, and are these wall hangings or footstool covers? The medium imbues these compositions with gendered connotations, while the orderly yet unpredictable arrangements gesture to a place where gender no longer necessitates hierarchy. Taeuber's self-portrait with earrings paired with her portrait of Arp, recognizable by his V-shaped coiffure, provide apt commentary as we review these telegraphed findings. Taeuber embraces her femininity, marking her difference from her partner not only by her slightly smaller stature, but also through the asymmetrical accoutrement. Remember now how Kandinsky described his painting as a conquest of virgin canvas. What do you think Münter made of this analogy? I don't want to be a Kandinsky and Arp apologist who says, well, yes, they were oblivious jerks, but they did the best they could given the language available to them at the time. The metaphor of imperious brush does capture Kandinsky's aspirations to conquer canvas and viewer alike, and the portrait busts capture the collegial intimacy between Arp and Taeuber, their playful embrace of gendered roles. The point is that Kandinsky could respect Münter as an artist and yet talk like this. Taeuber could assert herself in the professional arena and yet define herself like this vis-a-vis her partner. These are still familiar dynamics, problems women and men continue to face. Whether to laugh off misogynist rhetoric as mere language in order to keep peace, how to calibrate the gendered performativity of relationships, when to get rid of distinctions, and when to keep them. The implications, again, aren't just biographical, but also art historical. By focusing on these couples' intimate collegial relations, we gain insight into the stakes of abstraction in the early 20th century that would not be visible if we remained mired in narratives of individual genius, which somehow persist in dominating art history despite many efforts to the contrary. This event tonight suggests the widespread desire to move beyond that legacy. Thank you.